Okay, good morning, thank you. It's the second time I'm coming to the Nano Center meeting, annual meeting. And I think it's a great idea, because yesterday there was an excellent example for the benefit from such a meeting. So I'm not talking about people whom I hadn't met before at all. I'm talking about Oded, who sits in my corridor, two doors from me, and we do chat every day or every 2 days or something. And yet, only here in front of Kobe's poster did we understand that we should do something together. So that's, I think, the extreme example of benefits. Even people who think that they know each other very well can find common interests. So I'm going to tell you today about a work done by my PhD student, Naomi Oppenheimer, who couldn't come, unfortunately. And this work has to do with membranes, or biological membranes. By the way, are there still any biologists in the room? Okay, so I should be careful. So this talk has to do with how a physicist or a chemical physicist looks at a biological membrane. Okay, so that's a disclaimer. And already in this slide, you can see on the right is a cartoon of a biological, of a biomembrane, which was made by biologists, and this is a cartoon made by Naomi. Okay? So you can already see the difference. We are not looking at all the details that interest biologists. What we are trying to do is to characterize a biological membrane as a state of matter, as a type of material, and I'm going to try to convince you that it's a very special and interesting state of matter. So a biological membrane is one of the most common structures found in nature, in biology. It encircles any living cell and also all kinds of intracell organelles. And therefore, we would like to understand it. The basic building blocks are lipid molecules, which you can see here. And if you put them in solution, they have very low solubility, and therefore they self-assemble spontaneously into this bilayer membrane, whose width is a few nanometers, say 5 nanometers. In that bilayer of lipid molecules are embedded lots of macromolecules or membrane proteins, which perform key functions. For example, they perform all the signaling, all the communication that the cell creates with its environment are done via, is done via such membrane proteins. So the outline of the talk is going to be as follows. First of all, it's not, of course, it's self-evident why biologists should be interested in biomembranes. It is not self-evident why a physical chemist or a physicist should be interested in such. So the first issue would be, what is physically special about them? Then I'm going to go slowly through steps that I hope will make you understand the basics of the theory. The first step is to go to describe correlated motion of particles in a regular fluid, not in such a complicated case as a membrane, but just, let's say, in water or in oil. Then we'll move on to the theory of flow or hydrodynamics within membranes, and then we'll apply this theory to the correlated motion of particles in membranes, and the particles in membranes will be these embedded proteins. And I will finish with some, I hope I'll have time to finish with some interesting effects of the concentration of these particles on what we're going to see. So first, what is physically special about biomembranes? What is special for a chemical physicist? So the special thing as a state of matter is that it's a state of matter that has genuinely mixed dimensionality. You cannot say that it is 2D or 3D, and I'm going to demonstrate it now. First of all, if you talk about out-of-plane motion, out-of-plane dynamics, as demonstrated schematically here, because in the perpendicular direction, this structure is well-defined. These bilayers are well-defined. Molecules hardly leave because these lipids have very low solubility. They have a well-defined thickness, and therefore it is like a solid in the Z direction. Therefore, if you are interested in deformations out-of-plane, you are talking about, you are talking about an elastic response, okay? Because again, the structure is well defined in the direction. If you have a deformation, you will have a restoring force that will try to make this layer go back to a planar configuration. So in the Z direction, it's like a solid. or it responds elastically. And in fact, this elastic response of membranes in the Z direction what interested chemical physicists and physicists during the three decades of the last century, 70s, 80s, 90s, all the theoretical effort went into this characterization of a membrane as an elastic sheet. What is different from regular elastic sheets, what is common, and establishing the basic coarse grain theory of membrane deformation. So this is out of plane. But in plane, if we are talking about XY, the plane that contains the membrane, the structure is actually not well defined. These molecules can move freely, and it's a fluid in 2D. So in the out-of-plane direction, it's an elastic material, but in plane, it's a viscous liquid that can flow. Okay, so that's what I mean by mixed dimensionality. So as I said, in the last three decades of the 20th century, people were interested mainly in that and how proteins affect that, etc. The ongoing project that we are engaged in now is to characterize this material as a hydrodynamic medium, as a viscous liquid in plane, the 2D viscous liquid. And this talk is part of that ongoing project. Another example for the mixed dimensionality, you know that one of the first things that a theorist should be concerned with when you start dealing with a system is what are the conservation laws that are obeyed in this system. For example, yesterday Abraham told us that this molecular conduction is very different from regular conduction for regular electron transfer because electrons are not conserved. They can enter and go out, and therefore the theory looks very different. Similarly here, or in any theory, you should be concerned with what quantities are conserved. In usual liquid, let's say in a glass of water, you should conserve the liquid mass, the mass of the water, and the momentum of the water, but both in 3D, but for membranes, you should conserve the lipid mass. If things are going to flow in 2D, you have to conserve the number of lipids or the lipid mass in 2D, but then these molecules, since the membrane is embedded in a solution, they can collide with water molecules. If they flow, they also induce flow in the Z direction, in the surrounding solution, and therefore momentum is conserved not in 2D, but in 3D. Okay, so you have one conservation law in 2D and another conservation law in 3D. That's what makes this theory special, as you're going to see. So in our point of view, which is of course a non-biological point of view, we actually look at biomembranes as quasi-two-dimensional suspensions. Why two-dimensional? Because it's a sheet. Why quasi-two-dimensional? Because they do collide with water molecules, so you have to worry about the 3D solution in which this structure is embedded. So it's quasi-2D. Why suspension? Because it's not homogeneous. It has these particles, embedded proteins, which are much bigger than the lipids, and therefore they can be looked upon as an analogy of colloids in a suspension. Okay. So that's our point of view. So within this project, I'm going to address today two questions. Of course, these structures, the thickness is of order of a few nanometers and the proteins are of order of a few nanometers. So we are talking about thermal system at room temperature, at body temperature. And therefore, all these particles are Brownian. They undergo thermal fluctuations and they undergo Brownian motion. And the first question that we are going to ask is, since they are embedded in a membrane, their Brownian motion are not going to be independent. When one particle is going to move within the membrane, it's going to create flow, and this flow is going to affect the motion of the second particle. And therefore, the first question is how the Brownian motions of two particles are correlated via membrane flow. And the second specific question is, suppose we have many such particles, and we do, as you see in this cartoon, the concentration of proteins in membranes is very high, 10-20%. And therefore, if I have such a finite concentration of embedded proteins, of particles, how they affect the viscosity or the resistance of the membrane to flow compared to the case where they are absent, where the membrane is bare. Or in other words, how they affect the viscosity or the effective viscosity of the membrane in the presence of such inclusions. So these are the two questions. So the first stage in this voyage is to talk about correlated Brownian motion in regular fluids. Suppose you have two colloidal particles, nanoparticles, nanocrystal, whatever you like, and they sit in, let's say, water or in a solvent. The solvent has a certain viscosity, eta F, and the particles have a certain radius, A, and they're separated by a distance, R, and these are Brownian particles. And you ask the following question, how the Brownian motion of one particle affects the Brownian motion of the other? So how the Brownian motions are correlated? So first of all, of course, as we know for 100 years now, if we want to characterize the Brownian motion of a single particle, what we should do is look at the mean square displacement of a single particle. Let's call this particle particle 1, and it will have displacement in time x1, which will be a random variable. We have to take the mean square displacement of this variable, divide by time, and this gives us something which is called a diffusion constant, a diffusion coefficient, and this is a way to characterize the Brownian motion of a single particle. Similarly, if you would like to characterize the correlated Brownian motion, the correlations in the Brownian motion of two particles, you can define a correlation or a coupled diffusion coefficient, which is you can take the displacement of this particle, the random displacement of the second particle, multiply them, take a thermal average or a time average, divide by time, and you get a diffusion coefficient. And this diffusion coefficient, as you can easily see, does characterize the correlation in the motions of these two particles, because if they are not correlated, these two variables will be uncorrelated and you'll get zero. So if these two particles are uncorrelated, you get this DC, this coupling diffusion coefficient, as a vanishing coefficient. And if they are correlated, you get a non-vanishing value. What is different compared to two particles is that you have to worry now about the direction of the motion. Okay? So actually there are two coupling coefficients. One which describes the correlation in the Brownian motion along the line that connects the two particles, and this will be called D longitudinal. And another coefficient that characterizes the correlated in the Brownian motion perpendicular to the line that connects the two particles, and this will be called the transverse coefficient, DT. Okay? So that's a bit different. You have two coefficients, and the other difference is that, of course, this coefficient depends on the interparticle distance. If they are very, very far away, the correlation will be weak, and you'll measure a small coupling coefficient. Yes, sir?
There's also another
one. Into the plane.
No, that one is the next.
Cross correlation.
The cross correlation. So if you define the coordinate system properly, this one vanishes because in a homogeneous liquid, because this motion will be uncorrelated with that one. Yeah. So basically you have two coupling coefficients, which gives rise to four diffusion coefficients. But okay, never mind. So the other difference is that this coefficient depends on some distance, denoted here by R, which is the interparticle distance. Now, the main tool, the main theoretical tool, and I would like to comment that these coefficients, of course, this self-diffusion coefficient is something that has been measured since Perrin 100 years ago, and these coupling diffusion coefficients are regularly measured today by two particle tracking experiments. So these are quantities which are directly observed in experiments and easily measured. The theoretical tool to predict them, I'm not going into details, but what we concentrate on is what is called, or what we will call in this talk, the velocity response function, which means the following. If you go to a liquid and apply a force, suppose this is a volume of water and I come and apply a force, there will be some flow velocity in all positions of this liquid, and I ask what is the flow velocity in this point, direction and magnitude, in response to a point force or to a localized force that I applied here. This defines what we call a velocity or a flow response function, which we will call G. Since it depends on the direction of the force that I apply and the direction of the velocity, this is actually a set of functions, and therefore, which you can arrange in a matrix, and this is denoted by Gij here. The point is that if you can theoretically calculate this velocity response function, you're basically done, because thanks to a miracle called a miraculous theorem in statistical thermodynamics, this gives you immediately the coupling diffusion coefficients. These different functions give you immediately the coupling diffusion coefficients, but with a certain price, it gives you the coupling diffusion coefficients only in the limit where the interparticle distance is much larger than the particles themselves. What is nice about this scheme, despite this restriction of sufficiently large interparticle distances, is that these results are independent of particle size and shape. Actually, these results only describe the way this correlation is mediated by the fluid, not the way the perturbation was actually created by the particle, whether it's a sphere or a cylinder or whatever. And therefore, it has a certain extent of universality, which is always appealing. So that's about a regular liquid, let's say two particles in water. Now, as we said, a membrane is a structure of mixed dimensionality. So first, before coming to the real membrane, let's talk about three-dimensional liquids and two-dimensional liquids and see what happens next. So if I apply the formalism that I've just described to a three-dimensional liquid, say water, what you find is that this response function, this velocity response function, is actually a very slowly decaying function. It decays only like 1 over distance. This creates long-range correlations between particles in water or in any three-dimensional viscous liquid. The response function is also inversely proportional to the viscosity of the liquid. If you do the same calculation for a 2D liquid, you get that the correlation is actually even longer range. It decays only logarithmically with distance. And again, of course, it's inversely proportional to the two-dimensional viscosity of this fictitious two-dimensional liquid, which we will call in this talk eta M for membrane. This gives rise to correlated diffusion coefficients, which correspondingly decay as 1 over R in 3D and logarithmically in 2D. Okay, so what I would like to keep in mind for the rest of the talk is 3D is characterized, 3D behavior is characterized by by a correlation that is inversely proportional to distance and is proportional to 1 over eta F, the viscosity of the three-dimensional liquid. And the correlation in 2D is characterized by a logarithmic spatial dependence and is inversely proportional to the two-dimensional viscosity eta M. So the question is, what will happen in a membrane, which is both 2D and 3D? So that's the rest of the talk. So we go down to even more ridiculous cartoon. This is a cartoon that the physicists can look at. And in this cartoon, or in this model, the membrane is just a flat slab of viscous liquid with some inner viscosity eta in, which is much larger than the outer fluid, infinite fluid, which has viscosity eta f. And in this flat slab of viscous liquid, this is a membrane, it has some width w, is embedded an inclusion, let's say it's cylindrical, although most of the results I'm going to tell you are insensitive to the structure and shape of this inclusion. And this will be the protein. It's a cylinder of radius A. This model was not introduced by us. It was introduced in the mid-70s by Safman and Delbruck. It's a very famous and influential publication from 75. And their aim was to predict the diffusion coefficient of a single protein. Actually, there are many, many experiments focusing on the diffusion coefficient of a single protein in a membrane. And this theory was aimed at calculating this diffusion coefficient. There were other approaches along the year that I don't have time to dwell upon. And the important thing to keep in mind, or the important fact that comes out of this theory, is that there is a length scale, characteristic length scale, which we are going to denote kappa, inverse kappa. And this length scale comes from the ratio of the two-dimensional viscosity of the membrane and the three-dimensional viscosity of the embedding liquid, eta M over eta F. Since this is a 2D viscosity and this is a 3D viscosity, the ratio gives you a length. When you put numbers, you get a length which is much larger than the thickness of the membrane. Since the thickness of the membrane is nanoscale, this length is micrometer scale, let's say 0.1 micron to micron. So it's a large length, much larger than any interesting inclusion. And therefore, we are going to assume, and they assumed as well, that this kappa to the minus 1 is much larger than your particle size A. So the main prediction of that theory, of the Safman-Delbruck theory, is that the self-diffusion of a protein goes logarithmically with the protein size. This logarithm comes from this 2D behavior that I showed you in the previous slide. And this is, again, a very influential prediction that many people in the field know and follow. It has a teeny tiny problem, and that is, it is wrong. So most recent experiments, and this is a reference from 2006, it's most accurate measurement of a single protein, single membrane protein diffusion coefficient. Again, single protein in a membrane gives a diffusion coefficient which scales like 1/1 the protein size and not logarithmically. I mean, a prediction of a logarithmic dependence on size means that it is actually insensitive to the protein size, right? Because you cannot change protein size by many orders of magnitude. Now, our theory is going to be based on the Safman-Delbruck theory, and therefore you should say, oh, come on, you're basing your theory on something that has failed. But in science, usually we say that if a theory fails in comparison to experiment in science, you should throw it out. This is actually not true, because you can look at it, find out why it failed, and then use it further, but only the sides that if you understand why it failed, you can avoid the failure. And that's what we do. So why it fails? Again, it was shown that it fails because it has a single particle property. The prediction is about a single particle property. And of course, within this model, you see that the protein is a nice cylinder sitting, fitting very nicely into the membrane, which does not perturb the membrane, doesn't do anything to its surroundings, which is, of course, wrong. Any protein that is embedded in a membrane will perturb the structure of the membrane itself, of the medium around it. It will be perturbed elastically and dynamically. And if you include such a local perturbation that is induced by an inclusion, you do get a diffusion coefficient with scales like 1/1 size, and that's the reason why the Safman-Delbruck theory fails. Now, we are not going to talk or concentrate on single particle properties. We are going to concentrate on many particle properties and two particle properties. And as I showed you, once we take two particles to be sufficiently further apart than their size, the interparticle distance will be much larger than the particle size, then actually we should not worry about the shape of the protein, the local perturbation, the size. Things become much more universal, and therefore we bypass this failure. So what we are talking about are two inclusions, but within the same crude picture of a viscous slab inside a three-dimensional fluid. Again, this characteristic length, and we have two such inclusions that are separated by a distance r, and this r is much larger than a. That's the model. So the point is to find the velocity response function that I told you about earlier, and we did that analytically fully. And from that, you get for free, as I told you, from the fluctuation dissipation from this theorem of statistical thermodynamics, you get the coupling or the correlation diffusion coefficients in the longitudinal direction and the transverse direction, and we did that. I will not bore you with the expressions, but I would like to talk about two limits. One limit is very small distance. Again, not too small, so these two particles almost touch one another, but much smaller than this characteristic length, which is micron scale, as I told you. Okay? So distances which are much smaller than this kappa to the minus one, what you get is a behavior which looks like 2D. As I told you, please remember, when you see a log, this is like a 2D fluid, and you see here this 1/eta m, which is a two-dimensional viscosity, and therefore at small distances, these two particles are correlated as if they were inside a two-dimensional liquid, let's say a soap film. If you go to large distances, again, large compared to this micron scale length, you get a correlation that decays like 1/1 r, which, if you recall, characterizes a 3D response or a 3D correlation. So what happens? This kappa to the minus 1, this characteristic length, actually separates two regimes. At distances much smaller than kappa to the minus 1, correlation stresses are mediated through the membrane itself, and they do not care about the outer fluid. Therefore, you get a 2D-like behavior. But if you go to larger distances, what actually governs the way these particles are correlated are flows in the water, in the outer liquid. So you have this crossover from 2D to 3D behavior. And again, these results are independent of protein size and shape, which is nice. This is a graphical representation of that. This is a full solution, and you see these asymptotes, logarithmic asymptote, and the 1 over r asymptotes depicted here for the longitudinal and transverse coefficients. I would like to go in the last few minutes to what is called effective viscosity. So, again, the second question that we pose is if you have a finite concentration or finite volume fraction or area fraction of such proteins inside the membrane, what will be the effect on the viscosity of the membrane? So first, again, I would like to talk about what is effective viscosity. The way we define it is that if you calculate, again, this velocity response function in the presence of many particles, and suppose you have a certain volume fraction of particles, which we denote phi, you see that this response function goes over to some different response function, and the difference maybe the coefficient is just different. And as I told you, this response function is inversely proportional to the viscosity of your medium. And therefore, from that, you can extract, if you just look at how the prefactor of this function changes when you introduce inclusions or particles, you can define an effective viscosity. If you do it to a 3D suspension, to a 3D liquid water with some colloidal particles, you get that the effective viscosity is the original viscosity of the solvent with some correction due to the finite volume fraction of particles. This result was derived by no other than Albert Einstein many years ago. If you repeat Einstein's calculation for 2D liquid, you get that the effective viscosity, again, is the original viscosity of the 2D liquid, this fictitious liquid or a soap film, with some correction with a different coefficient, and here phi is the area fraction occupied by your particles inside the 2D liquid. So what will be with the membrane? The answer is as follows. Again, this is not a trivial calculation, but the result is almost self-evident. It turns out that when we do the same for a membrane, we find that the effective viscosity is corrected similarly to a two-dimensional suspension. Again, here phi is the area fraction of the membrane occupied by proteins. But that's not enough. You have also to correct this characteristic crossover length kappa to the minus 1. Why? Because it depends on membrane viscosity. And if the particles change the membrane viscosity, they will also change this characteristic length kappa to the minus 1. So you have also to rescale or correct that length, not only the prefactor, like here, but also the dependence on this length within the response function. And once you do that, you get the correct behavior. It's more or less to be expected. So that's about effective viscosity. Of course, when you have many particles, they will also affect what is directly measured, which is the correlation between two particles. So now we're talking about the pair correlation between two bounding particles, but in the presence of many others. Okay? So this will give us the original correlation coefficients plus some correction, which is linear in concentration in the area fraction. And because of this extra dependence of the characteristic length, kappa to the minus 1, on the concentration of particles, you get surprising results. The first is, usually viscosity, when viscosity increases because this coupling is inversely proportional to viscosity, the usual case is that when viscosity increases, the correlation between particles decreases. But in a membrane, because of this mixed dimensionality, things look differently. In the longitudinal coefficient, which is again the diffusion coefficient which characterizes the correlation in the diffusion in the bounding motion of two particles along the line that connects them, you find that there is no correction because the correction scales like 1 over distance squared, whereas the original coefficient scales like 1 over distance. And therefore, at large distances, you have a vanishing correction, a negligible correction. Not only that, you find that for the transverse coefficient, not only is there a correction, but it is in the opposite direction than the usual case. It's positive. So when you add proteins, these two particles that you are focusing on within the experiment actually become more correlated. So that's the emphasis on this plus sign here. It's a positive correction. And this is a graphical representation, and I'll just summarize. So there are several messages. The first message that, you might wonder whether they are correlated at all. And whether it's a short range correlation or long range correlation, what I showed you, first of all, that when two objects, proteins, move within a fluid membrane, they are correlated over long distances. The correlation actually decays at large. It's only like 1 over R, only like 1 over the interparticle distance. This is important to remember. So whenever you see proteins move, other proteins know about it dynamically. The longitudinal correction, correlation, that is how the motion is correlated along the connecting line, decays as 1 over distance, long range, and is independent of concentration at large distances, which is very strange. No matter how many proteins there are, you're going to measure the same correlation. The transverse correlation decays a bit faster, like 1 over distance squared, and actually increases with the concentration of proteins. And the effective viscosity is similar to that of a two-dimensional liquid, but you have also to change this length kappa to the minus 1. This was published. What we are doing now is extending the theory to supported membranes. In many realistic scenarios, in experimental cases, membranes are not freely floating, as we have assumed, but they are supported on a solid substrate, and therefore, and this should be taken into account, it has a tremendous, a very strong effect. And we are also now including immobile inclusions, so anchors or proteins that are actually that actually cannot move, and how they affect the response of the membrane to flow. Thank you. First question is a very good question, and the answer is basically no. It's a non-Newtonian liquid. The main non-Newtonian behavior actually comes from the out-of-plane motion, which is elastic. But also, you are right, within the plane, there may be non-Newtonian effects. In real biomembranes are never alone. They are connected to all kinds of scaffolds and elastic networks, as you probably know. And this introduces non-Newtonian effects, which we completely neglected here. So why did we neglect it? First of all, as we say in Hebrew, kau, yes, para parakon. Let's first understand this. But also, I mean, if you're interested in steady state, that is zero frequency, very long time, all these non-Newtonian effects are negligible. So you can tune your experiment to sample this Newtonian behavior. Regarding the second question, I'm not sure I understood it, but holding concentration in green membrane?
Yes.
Oh, okay, you should ask the biologist, but you're right that it's usually non-homogeneous. I mean, they are clustered, there are all these rafts, all the things that people are talking about. So is your question related to this these worries?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. You are right. Again, this is another cow. Sure.
That's
not the micelle, that's the vesicle. Micelles usually are much smaller, and I'm not talking about it. If you're talking about a spherical vesicle organ, like a liposome, as he talked about, well, Hezzy's liposomes are actually elastic, so let's forget about them. But let's say a membrane flows into a sphere, then it depends on how big the membrane is and the distance and the typical distances you are interested in. If your distances start to be comparable to the relative of curvature, you have to worry about it. Yeah. So if you like this theory, it should be valid only for giant unilamellar vesicles. So.
Real protein, I guess, protrude quite a lot into the water. So then the viscosity of water plays a role on the...
That's a very natural question because proteins do not fit so nicely into the membrane, but that's actually not a big worry. The reason is that the membrane viscosity, I always portrayed it as a 2D viscosity, but you can look at it as an effective 3D viscosity of this slab, is three orders of magnitude larger. And therefore, most of the stresses, most of the dissipation occurs within the membrane. And you have, if you will have a gigantic protrusion into water, eventually this will matter. But it should be almost of micron scale. Maybe that's not the word.
Yeah. Okay, this can try again.